What does a computer virus do? If you ask 10 people this question, you'll probably get 10 different answers. And that is no coincidence. This is because the computer virus, as we define it, has taken many different forms over the past several decades. Malware, virus, trojans. We tend to use these terms interchangeably in everyday conversation, despite them each having very distinct traits. It's all thanks to the complex evolution they have experienced alongside their machine counterparts. Our own creations are reflections of us, and so they behave in similar ways. Because it's not just our language and understanding of computer viruses that's evolving, but it's also the viruses themselves, undergoing an evolution that is technological as well as cultural. You see, not only has there been changes in how viruses work, but also why they work and the specific purposes they serve for the end user. Today, I thought we could explore each era of computer viruses and demonstrate some of my favorites. Now, of course, playing around with these programs is dangerous. Don't try this at home. And I like my computer. So I am going to be testing it on someone else's. Lou, get me a PC. Mini. I thought it would be fun to test it on this GEEKOM A6. Look how shiny and small this thing is. Snazzy. And under $500? Well, not for me because I stole it. I think there's something. There we go.
Password, no girls allowed. All right, right on.
I'm also curious to see how much energy each virus uses, so I'll be checking the temperature on it as I go. That'll really help put into perspective how powerful computers have become over time. Now, I want to be clear that the eras of computer malware that I'll be covering are obviously non-exhaustive. There's always going to be exceptions to the examples that I'll be showing. And a lot of these old viruses, unfortunately, are now lost media, so I won't be able to demonstrate all of them. In those instances, I will show examples of other viruses that are similar in their form and function. So without further ado, let's start at the very beginning. Back in 1949, way before we had the privilege of using small computers like the GEEKOM A6, use code NATIONS A6 for 5% off, computers were very big, and they were also way less powerful than they are today. So much so that our knowledge of their capabilities were still very limited. But it was at this time where mathematician John von Neumann proposed an interesting concept, that one day, computers would be smart enough to contain programs that could replicate themselves and spread across other computers, much like a biological virus. What's even more remarkable was that this theory was postulated before the internet or even its precursor, ARPANET, existed, and it more or less remained just a theory. Until 1971, that is when we were introduced to Creeper. No, not that Creeper, this Creeper. Instead of Dwemer artifacts, this creeper gave you a simple message on the screen. I'm the creeper. Catch me if you can. It is widely considered to be the very first ever computer virus, created by Bob Thomas and later refined by Ray Tomlinson, who is also considered one of the founding fathers of the internet. Unfortunately, there are no surviving original copies of Creeper available, but here is a simulation of what it would have looked like. Pretty basic stuff. This program did not actually do any harm, but it did replicate itself across mainframe computers with the same operating system, via ARPANET. It was designed explicitly to put this theory to the test, and it sure did. If you wanted to remove Creeper, you used a program called Reaper to do so, making it the first antivirus software. And so began the first era of computer viruses, the testing experimentation era. Over the next couple decades, as personal computers became a thing and got more advanced, people's ambition to make the most out of them grew as well, even those with more ulterior motives. The idea of computer software being able to spread and cause mild interruption and annoyance was quite interesting, so people started having fun with it. You then had programs popping up showcasing all the different ways they did this. I say programs rather than malware because, again, they didn't really cause any harm. It is malware in the sense that it isn't exactly software that's wanted or that the user consented to having installed, but they were really just gimmicky tests.
That hurts my ears.
Though it's also at around this time where that would start to change. When developers discovered that, in addition to creating something self-replicating, they could also make it cause real harm, they greatly took advantage of it. And that just became the norm for these types of programs. That is precisely why terms like malware, worm, and virus are often seen as synonymous, despite being different. All viruses are malware, but not all malware is a virus. Now that I've acknowledged that distinction, for the sake of simplicity, I will be using those terms interchangeably throughout this video. Programs such as Crash would infect all the .com files on your computer with this visual of rapidly changing bright colors and characters. This overwhelming process was sometimes even enough to crash the entire system, hence the name. Then, most notably, you have the first computer worm that would actually lead to a legal conviction in the United States, Morris. It began circulating in November of 1988 and took advantage of exploits that were found in the Unix operating system, notably found on VAX and Sun 3 computers. It was able to spread through what was basically an early version of email. It was also capable of even finding out your password if it was weak enough. The worm was created by its namesake, Robert Tappan Morris of Cornell University, basically to test and expand on these theories proposed by von Neumann. Morris was found to be in violation of the newly formed Computer Fraud and Abuse Act of 1986. He was subsequently sentenced to 3 years of probation, fined $10,000, and ordered to do 400 hours of community service. While Morris's motivations were purely academic, it does beg the question for why anyone in general would want to create something like this, and it's during the next era where we get some answers. In addition to sending itself to other computers through a network, developers were using their malware to send a message, often a political one. This is a practice known as hacktivism. Now there were programs that caused harm or annoyance as a form of protest against some kind of present issue. Some of my favorites include Cough Shop, which depicts a colorful visual accompanied by the text, "Legalize Cannabis." According to some sources, it also allegedly completely wiped the machine's memory, but unfortunately, I could not find any evidence for that. Hymn.com displays a series of colorful windows while playing the USSR national anthem. This virus emerged in 1990, just right before the end of the Cold War. It completely hangs the machine, and if you want to resume operation, you have to completely restart your system. I particularly like Marquez.com, which is just a bouncy visual that says, "Fortran must die." For those who may not know, Fortran is a programming language. Not exactly a political message, but still, a call for change. Notice how little energy these types of malware programs use, because they were, well, developed for much weaker machines. This is soon about to change. Though it is remarkable that even cheap computers still give us access to these legacy programs for research purposes. It really is the closest thing we have to a time machine. This looks familiar. Wait, I'm in 2021. It's me. Whoa, you look a lot like me. I'm you 4 years from now. Damn it, you are handsome. I was just thinking the same. Wait, I've seen this one. This is a classic. This is the legend of youareanidiot.org. What do you mean you've seen this? It's brand new. You know, I saw it on a rerun. What's a rerun? You'll find out. What is that thing you're holding in your hand? Oh, it's the GEEKOM A6. It's the next sponsor I'm doing. You're taking sponsorships now? Isn't that just a fancy word for selling out? Cam, you ignorant slut. GEEKOM is only the best mini PC under $500. What makes it so special? I thought you'd never ask. Well, for one, it's got an AMD 6800H processor and Radeon 680M GPU, so it's quite capable of handling things like office work, IT applications, video editing, even gaming. It achieves well-balanced performance thanks to its quiet and efficient cooling and supports multiple operating systems. It does all this in the palm of your hand. And if you run into any issues with its design and workmanship, GEEKOM offers a 3-year worry-free warranty from the date of purchase. Well, heavens to Betsy. When you put it that way, sounds like everyone needs a little bit of GEEKOM in their lives. Would I lie to you? If you use my code NATIONSA6 at checkout, you can get 5% off your purchase of the GEEKOM A6, available until April 1st. Thank you to GEEKOM for sponsoring this video. Now we enter the era of the World Wide Web, where we see the kind of viruses that most of us are familiar with. This is when stuff starts to get scary. With personal computers in most households by the end of the 90s, awareness for computer viruses increased significantly through, of course, antivirus software. But little did they know that this could just be another exploit for malicious developers. Instead of just creating some new dangerous program from the ground up, what if instead you could just impersonate something else? You now have something called rogue software. During this time, email sees an explosion in popularity, and so you start seeing a lot of computer worms pretending to be innocent little messages. This also came in the form of fake antivirus programs and through typo squatting, where malware creators would buy domains for slightly misspelled versions of already popular websites. The most notable example of this is goggle.com, which would destroy your computer if you were unlucky enough to make a typo while trying to access Google. One of the most infamous programs to come from this site was Spy Sheriff, a fake antivirus. It would give false alerts, and when you did a PC scan, it would replace your background with a fake blue screen of death, and even install itself in very high-level directories, making it incredibly difficult to remove. Basic uninstallations would just prompt it to reinstall itself once again. The only way to truly remove it is by paying to remove it. In this way, it's kind of a more subtle version of ransomware. Sure, it's not exactly threatening in that regard, but it does follow a pay-to-fix model in a similar way.
For like 3 years now, almost 4 years now, I've been trying to find this program and I've never been able to find it, and it looks like it did. So let's give it a try. Yeah, this was the one virus that I actually couldn't get to work properly for this demonstration. But while doing so, I actually ended up getting another virus unintentionally. I unintentionally installed malware while trying to intentionally install malware. We've come full circle. It literally won't let me click off anything at all. I can't even open Task Manager. This is crazy. I can't even check my temperature settings. Like nothing is like working. Skipping through all of these. How did this happen?
You also have examples of malware impersonating already existing programs, like the classic fake AVG program that's actually adware, that just spams your PC with pop-ups. By this time, computer viruses were very much known, and their cautious reputation started to have a bit of a novelty. And of course, developers took advantage of this as well. In addition to also being a sort of callback to the old school programs we discussed earlier, you then start to see more viruses that are designed pretty much exclusively to be humorous and irritating over actually being a threat. An example of this would be the Newton virus from 2005, and would move the icons around on your screen using the webcam's sensor. Then there's, of course, the aforementioned youareanidiot.org, a flash in JavaScript Trojan that completely flooded your screen with moving windows calling you an idiot that would multiply if you tried getting rid of them. This one was indirectly damaging because it could use up all your computer's memory and cause it to freeze, often leaving the user no choice but to forcefully restart their computer and potentially lose any unsaved data.
Here we go. Memory lane.
Don't
know. All right, days of old. Gonna close it. It's multiplying once again. Temperature's idle right now. Okay. Oh god, it's getting louder. Wow, that's really loud. Okay. The fans are like turning on this thing. I don't know if you can hear this, but that's what it sounds like. I can't even open Task Manager right now. It's like so bad. The temperature is really high right now. It is working hard for this thing. Poor little guy. Finally got Task Manager open. Let's see if sometimes if you close the process, it crashes the whole computer. Hopefully we don't get that. Oh, it didn't crash. Guess we got lucky.
And then there's one of my personal favorites, memes, or memes. A program created by a user named Luriak, who made it for the viewer-made malware series created by Daniel White of Dan00CT1.
All right. Memes. Here we go. Says, are you sure? Okay. I like that this one gives us two warnings, telling us that there's no going back, which means we're going to open it anyway. All right. It's running. Getting a bunch of pop-ups here. Looks like some fictitious antivirus software. Okay, randomly opening my registry keys. That's comforting. Whoa, this is weird. Oh my gosh, this is cool. Ow, that's really loud though. Ugh, that's really loud. Oh my gosh, I can't even like, again, task manager's not working. That is really heating up here. Wow, okay. Maybe if I try Control-Alt-Delete, that'll do something. Okay, I think I can shut it down from here. Let's try. Uh-oh, it did not like that. I'm seeing a bunch of error messages pop up. Oh, and we're done for. Let's try booting it back up.
But this one actually completely wipes your system. At least some variants of it do.
Oh, wow. It actually deleted everything. I mean, it said that it would, but I was not expecting it to do it to that degree. Yeah, I can't open it at all. I like how the most damaging virus was the easiest one to install. It's like rain on your wedding day.
These types of viruses are particularly my favorite because they just really embrace all those stereotypes that computer viruses have. The ones that you'd see in cheesy movies and TV shows. Most of the malware we encounter is a lot more subtle and sinister and doesn't really have this humorous angle to them. Which brings us to now. The internet is bigger than ever before and more commercialized than ever before. So now malware tends to have much more of a monetary incentive to it. We are arguably in the era of ransomware. Of course, ransomware existed as far back as the late 80s, even hacktivism ransomware such as the AIDS Trojan horse. Its creator argued that all the money collected would be used to fund AIDS research. But now, ransomware is stronger than it has ever been before. In 2017, we saw what is currently one of the biggest cyber attacks in history, WannaCry. Originating in North Korea, this virus would encrypt every single file on your computer, permanently denying access unless payment was made. The only other recourse was to completely wipe your hard drive and start over. Many of those who didn't already have backups lost everything. This virus spread through an exploit found in Microsoft's server message block, a protocol that allows for various computer nodes on a network to communicate with one another.
I'm actually very scared to run this one because apparently it can pass through virtual machines and go over networks. So I tried to quarantine it as best as possible, but moment of truth. Wow. Yeah, it really did encrypt everything. Everything is... Yeah, and there's my background changed. Wow, look at that. You can see how weird the language is on this. You can tell it's not written by like a professional company. It's very much like, you know, a rogue, like amateur setup. Yeah, and you know, you have to pay to get it fixed. Pretty crazy.
It affected as many as 200,000 computers, costing around $4 billion in damage. With new variants popping up that circumvent the patches that initially killed it, the WannaCry virus is still active today. I would love to cover the WannaCry story in much more detail in a future video, so let me know in the comments down below if you'd like to see that. But this was by far the scariest one for me to try out. Once again, I would like to point out that these eras are not mutually exclusive, and you will certainly find examples of overlap between them, but they do showcase an overall pattern in how technology evolves alongside culture. And it makes sense why it would show up in this way. As computers get smaller, cheaper, and become more capable of doing great things, they also further open the door to new threats that were once inconceivable. By becoming more informed about how these programs evolve, we can better educate ourselves on what to expect and how to minimize the harm they may cause to us and others. Once again, I'd like to thank GEEKOM for making this video possible. Probably shouldn't do that. Again, if you're looking for a PC on a budget, make sure to use my code NATIONSA6 to get 5% off your order. If you'd like to see more videos of mine about computer viruses, you can check out my playlist right here. A special thanks to all my Patreon supporters. Patreon.com/NATIONSQUID. Buying me a coffee is also very much appreciated. Thank you for watching, everyone.